this week's show, Nissan prepares for 2G switch-off, Hyundai debuts the IONIQ, and British firm Morgan unveils a gorgeous electric three-wheeler that we really, really want. These stories and more coming up next on 10. Enjoying today's show on YouTube and want to read the stories we're referring to today? Just head to our website at transportevolved.com/TEN, where you'll find today's show notes, as well as links to the latest future car news, buying guides, tech primers, and car reviews. It's Friday, March 4th, 2016. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield, and yet again, our Patreon supporters have come through for us this month. We are actually within spitting distance of the halfway point to our next target, so please keep those donations coming in. It's pretty unusual that we get to start the show 2 weeks in a row with an almost identical story, but this week that's exactly what we're doing. Last week we told you about a security flaw in Nissan's recently launched Nissan Connect EV telematics system for electric cars. This week we're bringing you the news that owners of existing 2011 through 2015 Nissan Leafs in North America will find themselves needing a telematics upgrade before the end of the year that they actually might end up having to pay for. As we explain this week, it's all down to AT&T, which is Nissan's data provider of choice. You see, it's going to switch off the last of its 2G cell towers by the end of this year, because most cell phones today really rely on 3G or perhaps even 4G data connections. And while you might think of the Nissan Leaf as a cutting-edge car, Nissan actually used slow 2G data connectivity as the backbone to its electric car telematics system on every 2011 through 2015 Nissan Leaf. With the cell towers getting switched off this year, Nissan says it's hard at work developing a replacement module to ensure customers' cars can still connect to its Nissan Connect portal. But while it will pay for a free upgrade for owners of the 2015 Nissan Leaf's telematics system, Nissan says customers of older cars will need to contribute something towards the cost, even though it's filling in the lion's share of the bill. How much will that be? We don't have the figure yet, but when we do, we'll let you know. Something else that is a bit of an unknown this week is the status of an inquiry made by the US EPA this week of German luxury brand Mercedes-Benz. As we reported on Monday, the EPA has asked the high-end automaker to provide additional detailed data on tailpipe emissions of some of its diesel-powered vehicles after a class action lawsuit was filed against the brand in New Jersey last month. Citing data obtained by the Dutch government in official emissions testing, the court case alleges that, like Volkswagen, Mercedes-Benz so-called clean diesel engines, which were sold in the US under the Blue Tech badge, do not meet US emissions standards for diesel-engined cars and can, under some situations, emit more than 60 times the legal NOx limit. At the moment, the EPA isn't conducting an official investigation, although we're guessing that if it's unhappy with the data provided to it by Mercedes-Benz, or if its own tests find something untoward going on, there could be two German makers in the penalty box for misinforming the public about how clean, or unclean, diesel engines really can be. An automaker which shouldn't have to worry about such things all that much is Hyundai, because it hasn't ever invested in heavily diesel engine technology. And this week, on the opening day of the 2016 Geneva Motor Show, the South Korean automaker gave its brand new IONIQ sedan its global auto show debut. What makes the IONIQ different from other cars, I hear you ask? Well, the IONIQ will be offered with a choice of three different drivetrain options. And those options don't include a traditional diesel or gasoline engine. Instead, the IONIQ, due to launch as a 2017 car later this year, will launch globally with a choice of hybrid, plug-in hybrid, or all-electric drivetrains. It's clear Hyundai wants to tackle the Toyota Prius, Chevrolet Volt, and Nissan Leaf with its trio of drivetrain options. But on paper, the IONIQ's various power plants will match rather than surpass its current competitors in terms of fuel efficiency and range. We don't have time, unfortunately, to go into all the options here, but we think Hyundai's high brand reputation in the US, combined with its long warranty options, mean that the IONIQ is certainly a car to keep your eyes on, even if it's not breaking any new boundaries in terms of performance and economy. But a company which is very keen to do just that is enigmatic startup from Silicon Valley, FF, which announced, rather breathlessly this week, that it has a brand new patent from the US Patents and Trademark Office for a type of power inverter that it says will be at the heart of its future vehicles. It claims the new unit uses far less transistors and is a less complicated design than some other inverters on the market, resulting in a smaller footprint and a power-to-weight density 20 to 30 times higher than inverters used in other electric cars. The result is a good-looking inverter, but having looked through the patent and having asked several specialists in the field, we really can't see what makes this inverter so special, nor can we really honestly see why it was granted a patent. But we're nice folks here at Transport Evolved, seeing as FF doesn't have a car or a factory yet, we'll let you have this patent. You're welcome. From FF to a company it one day hopes to beat, Tesla Motors. And while FF has very little to show for its efforts, Tesla has started sending out invites to its official Tesla Model 3 reveal event, scheduled for just under 4 weeks' time on March 31st. We still have very little in the way to share in the way of news about what we can expect of this brand new Tesla. But as we told you last month, Tesla will begin taking reservations for its first truly affordable electric car on March 31st in Tesla stores and April 1st through its online system. While we've yet to get our official invite, and if we're honest, we probably won't get one, you can be sure that we'll cover the event as live as always over the transportevolve.com website. Tesla might be readying itself to unveil its latest production car, but last Thursday, after we'd already filmed the week's show, a late-breaking piece of news surfaced surrounding the Tesla Roadster two-seat sports sedan, which gave Tesla the start in life. What's more, if you have a Tesla Roadster, this piece of news is probably going to get you very excited indeed. You see, while the Tesla Model S, Model X, and we presume Model 3 will rely on Tesla's proprietary supercharger network to give them quick refuels on long-distance trips, owners of the original Roadster have had to be content thus far with the 80 amps maximum charge, or 20 kilowatts, that the Roadster came from the factory with. But now, for a sizable fee, Tony Williams of Quick Charge Power has completed successful testing of the Tesla Roadster-specific CHAdeMO aftermarket adapter kit for the Roadster, called JdeMO. And the videos of the first Tesla Roadsters using that system were posted online this time last week. It's early days, but this system more than doubles the maximum speed a Tesla Roadster can charge at and works with any CHAdeMO-compatible charging station. If you're interested, be sure to head to our site for more info. Just down the road from Tesla's headquarters, you'll find Google's headquarters, or rather Alphabet, as it prefers to be known today. Regardless of its name, however, Google made the headlines this week after admitting that one of its cars had been involved in a collision with a bus in February, and that its autonomous drive software, yes, the same software NHTSA said was good enough to be considered the legal driver, was actually to blame. As we discovered this week, the minor collision happened when an autonomous vehicle, which was trying to navigate around some sandbags in the road at a speed of around 2 miles per hour, ended up coming to blows with a local bus. It was just a glancing blow. Nobody was hurt, but at the time, Google is to have reported to have said that the operator behind the wheel of the self-driving car had assumed the bus would stop and wait for the car to pass the narrow section before trying to carry on through itself. But in a statement issued midweek, Google basically said that while it had expected the bus to stop, from now on it would make sure that its cars understood that large vehicles are far less likely to yield, even if the car has the original right of way. So this is kind of like driver's ed 101 for autonomous vehicles, right? I mean, we've all done it before. Well, I've not hit a bus, of course, but not to get all Deadpool on you here. It's the kind of brown pants moment that we all have when we first learn to drive. Am I right? Or do I just need to go and get some chimichangas? Oh, okay. Enough of the film references, although I'm sure this next story involves a company who many of you wouldn't mind being visited by that crazy red-suited guy. That's because we're back to Geneva with this next story and Audi, Volkswagen's premium marque, which said this week that, in the light of Dieselgate, it was going to become Volkswagen's centre for both electrification excellence and hydrogen fuel cell development. In short, it means that Audi is going to be the place where Volkswagen's battery technology, electric car drivetrains, and hydrogen fuel cell platforms will be developed. And that's great, but we'd like to remind viewers that Audi was in fact responsible for developing at least one of those diesel engines which put Volkswagen in such trouble last year. Anyway, I digress. Speaking in Geneva, Audi's CFO, Axel Strutbeck, said that alongside the upcoming 2018 Audi e-tron Quattro SUV, Audi Brussels will be the pioneer of battery technology, developing both new battery chemistries with its partners LG Chem and Samsung SDI, as well as pushing the boundaries of hydrogen fuel cell technology with an h-tron line of vehicles alongside the e-tron line of plug-ins. Talk is easy, though, and we'll be keeping an eye on Audi very closely until we see some actual vehicles we can sit behind and drive. Watch this space. And finally, for those who don't know, our editorial team has a penchant for classic cars and awesome engineering just as much as we do cleaner, greener, safer and smarter cars. And this week at the Geneva Motor Show, we got a treat in the form of the Morgan EV3, a car which combines our love of classic car design with an all-electric drivetrain and some old-fashioned engineering. EV3, I hear you say? Yes, EV3. Because the Morgan EV3 is, of course, a three-wheeler with two front wheels and one rear. If that seems a little old-fashioned, it's because it is. Morgan has been making three-wheelers in this configuration for more than a century and has followed the same basic slender handcrafted design for the past 80 years or so. I actually asked our contributor and my good personal friend, Kate Wharton-Elliott, to write a piece about the EV3 this week, and she refused because, and I quote, "I'd just be drooling on the keyboard." I'm pretty much the same, but having got used to writing upwards of 5,000 words a day, I managed to keep it together long enough to bash out a story. You're welcome. Talking of drool, that's what I'm going to be doing this weekend, because our brand new staff car, yes, a classic 2002 Toyota RAV4 EV, is arriving from Southern California to start a new life here in Oregon. Yes! We'll be keeping you up to date with its restoration. In the meantime, you can find all the news that's fit to print at our website at transportevolve.com. Catch up with us on Twitter at transportevolve, or check out our latest shows on our usual YouTube channel. And if you liked what you saw today, please consider keeping us independent and impartial by visiting our Patreon page at patreon.com/transportevolved and pledging your support from as little as $1 per month. As I've said before, it's our only form of income, and I would really love to be able to start paying contributors very soon. So please consider helping us. Right now, about 0.1% of all of our visitors make a donation. Let's make it nearer to that 1%, eh? As always, there's a lot we haven't managed to fit into today's show, including why Ferrari will never make an electric car. Nissan tells us what the city of the future will be like thanks to its electric cars and smart grid technology. British comedian Simon Brodkin tries to install a cheat box in a Volkswagen up on stage live during the Geneva Motor Show. It was brilliant. And we tell you more about Sparky, our new staff car. So when we're done, be sure to head to our site to read them all. Thanks for watching. I'm Nikki Gordon-Bloomfield. Have a great weekend, and until next time, keep evolving.